Oxygen, Plaza Non-Metals. You remember? What is the product? Oxygen plus non-metal produce acidic oxide. Alright, acidic oxide. Examples. For example, oxygen and non-metal is nitrous oxides, sulfur oxides, phosphorus oxides, and carbonic oxides, carbon oxide. Those oxide plus water produce nitric acid, sulfuric acid, phosphoric acid, carbonic acid, acids. Those are acids. And the acids are highly corrosive. This is in the case when you have oxygen and non-metals. You produce acids. And now we are going to check what happened when we have oxygen plus metals. We have oxygen plus metal, we have basic oxides. No? For example, oxygen plus sodium, oxygen plus calcium. Oxygen plus sodium is oxygen plus calcium. Yeah, those are basic oxides. The basic oxides plus water produce hydroxides. Hydroxide of sodium, hydroxide of potassium, and other ones. Okay? And those are bases. Nice, no? But streams are highly corrosive. More acidic or more alkaline, both of them produce high level of corrosion. Yes, my friend, you remember where is used hydroxide of sodium and hydroxide of potassium? You remember that product? Light. To clean sanitation system, to clean fresh water systems in your home. That white powder is highly corrosive, highly corrosive. You need added and flush immediately. If not, the pipes of the sink in your home is perforated, highly corrosive. Oh, the same like the acids. With the acids, you have the same situation. Chlorhydric acid, sulfuric acid, nitric acid, phosphoric acid, all of them are highly corrosive, but streams are highly corrosive. How the pH affect the level of corrosion? Pay attention. But acids and alkalis are highly corrosive. Both of them produce or accelerate the corrosion. Alkali, I explained to yours, or acid. But streams are not good. For that reason, if you have a pH with a close to zero, is acid. In this is acid. Or if you have a pH around 14, is alkali in this corner. Alkali or acid? For that reason, the secret is try to be located in this area in the middle of this scale. Not too much acid, not too much alkali, in the middle is a good scenario to reduce the phenomenon of corrosion. To reduce, no, stop is practically impossible. How to check the pH? You can check the pH with an indicator. It's a piece of paper. It's a piece of paper, the pH indicator. When the paper is introduced in the solution, change the color. Simple. Each different color indicate the level of pH. You can buy those test strips. Those test strips in all the marine marine shops, West Marine, all of them, they sell test strips in Amazon, in internet. I recommend keep in your boat those strips in order to check the level of alkalinity in the solution. Those are similar than the paper strips that you use to check the condition of the coolant. You remember in our diesel course, those strips is basically the same to check the alkalinity of the solution. You remember when you use the SCAs in order to identify if the level of SCAs is good in the coolant, is basically an indicator of the pH. You remember that one? It's exactly the same like this, okay? In order to check the level of alkalinity. We are going to check the method, the three methods. This is the first one, in order to check the voltage. You see that picture? Let me I analyze the picture carefully. This is the battery, and we are going to disconnect the positive, the main positive of the battery from the positive terminal of the battery. And I am going to insert in series my multimeter. For both methods, the multimeter should be inserted in series. Look at this. In this particular case, if I disconnect the positive cable and I try to check volts, this is the DC panel, for example. I disconnect the positive in between the positive terminal of the battery and the cable. I disconnect the cable and I insert my voltmeter in series over there, volts DC. How much should be the reading of the voltage? Should be zero because it's positive with positive. No, I have 12. It's because in the boat, you have some equipment touching the ground. For that reason, you read 12. In that point. Simple. Okay. In between this and this, I am going to install a breaker. And I interrupt with the breaker in order to avoid separate that big cable. I install a breaker right now in the video clip. I am going to show that procedure. All right? It's not complicated. This is the volt method. Once again, I'm going to separate the positive terminal of the battery, or I am going to install an interrupter over there and I open. When the interrupter is off, when the breaker is off, it's because the terminals are on. Look, if it's off, it's because the terminals, the contacts are open. If it's on, it's because the terminals are closed. Don't forget that. It's off. The terminals are open. Okay? All right. Once again, this is the switch selector, the positive, the main breaker of the panel. In some small boat with a DC panel, they don't have main breaker. The positive enter in the common of the breakers, that one. And in the output of each breaker, you have the connection to each equipment, to each motor, to each appliance. Each equipment have your own switch. The switch, for example, this is a vacuum. Oh, the equipment is connected to the power, but this is the switch to activate the motor. the appliance. Alright? What is the idea? The main breaker is on, contacts closed. And all the small breakers are on, contact closed. However, the equipment is off, because the breaker at the input of the equipment is off. And I am going to disconnect the positive from the terminal of the battery, and I am going to insert my multimeter over there. In normal conditions, the reading should be zero. Zero! Zero! Because it's the positive. You have the positive cable, you interrupt the positive, and you try to read voltage in between this and this. It's zero. It's zero. Oh, I have 12. It's because in the other side, some equipment is touching the ground. You have a leak. For that reason, you have 12 volts over there.
Hey guys, I have a board that I prepared in order to understand the procedure to identify where are the leaks. This is the typical DC panel. This is the DC wiring in a bulb. I have the DC panel with a meter, voltmeter. I have five elements connected right now. I have the fresh water pump, the blower, bilge pump, navigation lights, cabin lights, and the horn. All of those elements are working. The pump, the light, the bilge pump, everything is running in good condition. I am going to use both methods, the method of the voltage and the method of the amps. This is the connection. The positive of the battery is interrupted here, the positive enter here, and I interrupt with this breaker. And the positive continue. The positive continue here in the fuse, enter in the chant for the ammeter, that's the chant for the ammeter, and the positive enter in the positive boost bar of the panel. The negative boost bar is connected with the negative, and is connected with the negative of the battery. The rest of the elements, this is the ignition boost bar, and this is the wiring for this particular boat. Now, I am going to try to connect my voltmeter in series according with the diagram. In the diagram, if you see, the negative is connected with the positive of the battery. This is the positive of the battery. I am going to select volts DC, volts DC. The positive of the battery is here, and this is the other positive. I interrupt over there. In the other positive, I connect here. Normally, the reading, because I interrupt the positive, the reading between those points is zero. If I have the voltage of the battery, 11 volts or 12 volts, the voltage of the battery is because after that, some equipment have a leak. Some equipment have a return to ground. Let me check. Oh, I have 11 volts. I have 11 volts. What is the meaning of that? Is because one of the equipments have a leak. Okay guys, everything is running. Right now I am going to disconnect that breaker. I am going to interrupt the positive. And now I am going to check the voltage over there. And the voltage is 12 volts. It's supposed that it's interrupted. I separate the positive here. If I connect, everything is running. Okay, I separate the positive and I connect my voltmeter in series on the separation. And I have 11.6, the voltage of the battery. What is the meaning of that? That I have a leak in one of those equipments. Where is the leak? One method is I disconnect in the output of each breaker the equipment, and I verify in what moment the voltage become zero. This is a perfect indication. All right? And I am going to verify with the method of amps. Let me explain what happened with the method of AMS. With the method of AMS, once again, I am going to switch the terminal in my multimeter into AMS, and right now I can select AMS, and I am ready. Once again, the positive of the battery with the negative terminal, and the positive of the multimeter with the other positive that enter in the system. If the reading in amps is more than 0.001, it's because I have a leak. With the volt method, I verify that I have a leak. I am going to verify again with the amp method. All right? 0.03. 0.029. 0.03. This is more than 0.001. This is an indication. This is an indication that I have a leak. Now I am going to disconnect in the other side the breaker with the problem, and immediately the voltage will be zero. Now I am going to disconnect the terminal of the pump, and I am going to verify what happened. Now the flow of amps is zero. It's because this pump is the equipment with the leak. This is a simple technique to identify where is the leak. With the volt method, the amps method, or the ohms. In the ohms method, is not accurate because you have too much returns. In the both methods, is with the negative terminal of the battery with the multimeter in ohms. But I have a lot of experience with that method, and always is erratic because you have a lot of returns. For that reason, I prefer the volt or the ohms method.
Electrical potential. This is the topic that we talked before, is the difference in energy and why that difference is critical. All the metals generate a negative voltage in comparison to the reference electrode when this metal is immersed in water. In this example, we are going to analyze. I have a propeller in bronze, and we are going to try to protect the propeller with the three different sacrificial anodes. We are going to protect the propeller with zinc, we are going to protect the propeller with aluminum, and we are going to protect the propeller with magnesium. And we are going to try to check which sacrificial anode produce the highest potential difference. For example, with zinc is minus 1.0 volts, and the bronze is minus 0.3. The difference, minus 1.05, minus 0.3 is 0.75 negative. This is with zinc. If I use aluminum, the result is minus 0.8. If I use magnesium, the result is minus 1.3 volts. Of course, with magnesium, I produce a higher potential difference. Nice, interesting. In general, you think that zinc is better. Today, we are going to demonstrate that not always. In some situations, aluminum is better. In other situations, magnesium is better. Okay? We are going to check what happened with the different type of alloys. For example, we are going to check aluminum sacrificial anodes. The most common alloy is the SAMAC. SAMAC is an alloy based on zinc. the technical name is MIL-A24779. This is the technical name of the SAMAC. This is the name of this aluminum alloy. The content of this aluminum alloy, this is an aluminum alloy, SAMAC, is the content of zinc is in between 4 and 6.5%. The content of mercury is a little less than 1,000. The content of copper is a little less of 4,000. Silica is in between 0.08 and 0.2%. Iron is around 0.09%. And the rest is aluminum. This is SAMAC. This is the most common aluminum alloy. It's basically 93% of aluminum, and the rest is zinc with other ingredients. You know, that aluminum alloy have a high content of zinc. Zinc is the secret, okay? But the aluminum appropriated alloy with other metals produce excellent levels of energy, low level of energy. What is the idea? You need to protect the metal with a sacrificial anode with low level of energy. That metal, that sacrificial anode, will be eroded because it's less noble than this one. Can I protect aluminum with a sacrificial anode of an aluminum alloy? Yes, because the marine alloys for sacrificial anodes, they have lower level of energy in comparison with aluminum. For that reason, there are anodes in aluminum alloys used for aluminum boats, because the level of energy of this alloy is too low, and of course this alloy works properly with this in order to protect this hole in aluminum. Yes, there are sacrificial anodes in aluminum alloys good for aluminum boats. Now we are going to check that situation. Okay, SAMAC is an aluminum alloy with a content of around 6.5% of zinc, and the rest is copper, silica, mercury, and iron. Other important alloys are the martyr sacrificial anodes. Martyr. What is the meaning of that? There are two types of martyr alloys. Martyr 1 is zinc alloys, and martyr 2 are aluminum alloys. Martyr 1 are zinc alloys, and martyr 2 are aluminum alloys. Okay, we are going to check martyr 1 and martyr 2. Okay, martyr 1, look at this. It's an alloy with a high content of cadmium. You remember in the periodic table that group, zinc, cadmium, and mercury? Those three elements are excellent because they have in the last orbit only two electrons. Because they have two electrons in the last orbit, the oxygen prefer those elements to attack those elements in comparison with other ones with three electrons in the last orbit. Yes, in general, zinc is better because zinc is poison a little, but is not expensive. It's easy to find zinc in comparison with mercury. Mercury is high poison and is expensive and is liquid in natural state. And cadmium is also poison, is too expensive, and cadmium is used in the fabrication of batteries because cadmium is a great storage material of electrons. Okay, for that reason, zinc is used in general for the fabrication of sacrificial anodes. But this alloy, Martyr 1, have a good content of cadmium. Have a copper, iron, lead, aluminum, and zinc practically 99.4%. It's practically pure zinc with a little amount of cadmium and other ingredients. This is martyr one. Look at this. The potential difference for this alloy is 355 amps per hour per pound. What is the meaning of that? This means that a zinc anode will give 1 amp per 355 hours per each pound of zinc. This is an important number, and now we are going to do the comparison with the next one. With martyr 2, martyr 2 is an aluminum alloy, is practically 93% of aluminum with high content of zinc, around 6.5%, and other ingredients like a copper, iron, indium is an other group, good element located in the group number 3, mercury and silica. But the higher content is aluminum and zinc. This is an aluminum alloy, martyr 2, and this alloy, look at the intensity, is 1225 amps per hour per pound. What is the meaning of that? This anode will give 1 amp per each 1225 hours of every pound of zinc. Yes, in comparison with the previous one, is with a 355. This is a zinc alloy, is 355 amps per pound. Amps per pound. And this one, if this is an aluminum alloy, is 1225 amps per pound. This is better. This is better. What is the meaning of that? The intensity is higher with this aluminum alloy, and the protection is better. The potential difference is higher. When the potential difference is pretty close, that anode is not working because it's the same level of energy. You need an anode with lower level of energy in order to produce a high arc, in order to erode easily the sacrificial anode and protect the metal. This is the secret. Select sacrificial anode with lower level of energy in order to create high potential difference. Now we are going to introduce another system. It's the impressed current cathodic protection. Impressed current cathodic protection. This is, in my opinion, a magic design, a wonderful idea that is used every day more and more. Today is used in big boats, in mega yachts, especially in a boat with a metallic structure, and is also used in fiberglass boats, basically in a steam drive system. I'm going to explain later at the end of this episode where is used and how is used and what is the name of that system. In order to understand the second method, the impressed current cathodic protection system, impressed current, we need to refresh our concept of basic chemistry. You remember at the beginning of this book when we talk about the periodic table, the organization of the elements in the periodic tables, and why some elements are located in one group and in other group. You remember the element located in the group number 8 in the last one? They are called noble gases or noble elements because they have in the last orbit, you remember, 8 electrons. And you remember that the elements in the group number 7 and 6, pretty close to the group number 8, those are the elements with higher energy. They are pretty close to be stable. They need one more or two more electrons to be stable. And we know that the element located in the group number 1 and 2, they normally are donors. They are sacrificial elements. They release the electrons. Yeah? And elements with the 3 electrons also, metals. They have less energy than those elements in the group 6 and 7 chlorine, chlorine. Those elements and oxygen with high level of energy, and they are pretty close to be stable. They only need one or two electrons to be stable. With that concept, the engineers create the impressive current cathodic protection system. And they say, okay, when an element is stable, or a molecule is stable, you remember an example of stable molecules? Water. Water is stable because the molecule is stable, 8 electrons. And water, you remember quickly? Water is H2O, you remember? It's two hydrogens, and one oxygen with 6 electrons in the last orbit, and the hydrogen with 2 electrons in the last orbit. The hydrogen with less energy release the electron, the oxygen complete 8, and the hydrogens 0 and 0, and the molecule is stable. There are other stable molecules. You remember carbon dioxide is stable. Carbon monoxide, no. Those are stable molecules, stable elements. The engineer said, hey, what happened if I try to saturate the structure of my boat? Suppose that I have a boat in aluminum, or I have a boat in steel. What happened if I send a lot of electrons, I bombardier the structure with electrons, and I saturate the structure? If the structure is stable, fully saturated of electrons in the last orbit, the oxygen no attack the structure, and the structure is not oxidized. Bingo! Excellent idea! Excellent idea! It's perfect! I am going to saturate the structure full of electrons, and right now the structure is stable, no react, and the oxygen no attack because it's stable. Good idea! How can I bombardier with electrons the structure? It's too simple. The people locate an electrode close to the structure, not necessarily touching the structure. You can touch with the sacrificial anode destructor, or pretty close, and you introduce current in the anode, not in the structure. In the structure, only the negative. And the positive of the anode, because it's pretty close, create a flow of electrons that saturate the structure. This is commonly used in the oil companies, the pipelines of the oil companies. You see, the pipe is protected with the anode. The anode is on the ground, inserted on the ground, is separated from the pipes, and look, the negative is connected to the structure on top, and the anode create the flow of electrons, and the electrons saturate the pipe, and the pipe is protected. The oxygen now corrode the pipe. Wow! Yes, my friends, this is the procedure to protect the pipes, the steel pipes, in the oil companies. It's a great idea. It's a perfect idea. And it's also used in mega yachts, in mega containers, the impressive current protection system. Yes, my friend, this is the secret.